Well, here we are charging another big wave, right? Another big taping. But what else is there to do? Especially when it's raining like this in California, right? And so I just hunker down and just keep pumping out the hits. So that's what we're doing here. I had the most extraordinary experience today that is super relevant to what's going on. It's absolutely the grace of God. The grace of God is doing all sorts of powerful interventions in my life right now. This one gave me goosebumps. It was so extraordinary. I met this man. There was this man rummaging through a dumpster, and I walked up to him and said, "Hey, finding anything?" Instead of disparaging him or thinking, "Oh, there's some bum there or something," I just said, "You know, I just feel like, hey, just let everything be. Everything's the grace of God. Let me be nice." And I just felt that way. And we ended up getting into a conversation. And that conversation really lasted and was very full and amazing. He was quite an amazing man. He was 80 years old and he was sharp as a tack. And I just felt like, who's this? He seems familiar to me. It was really something. And here's the story he told me. And it's just, an amazing story. His wife is German. I said, "Is she from actually Germany? Actually, native Germany?" He says, "Oh yeah. In fact, her father was in the Battle of Stalingrad in World War II, Stalingrad." I said, "Whoa! How did he survive? I mean, that was horrible." He said, "Yeah. As a matter of fact, Germans had 600,000 of their finest troops in the siege of Stalingrad." And he said, "This is what happened, is that their retreat lines were guarded by the Italians. And when winter came, the Italians, they got, say, it's too cold. Hey, we're from the Mediterranean climate. We don't like this cold." They all left. They all left. Went back to Italy. Didn't ask the Germans to permission, right? What kind of nice allies, huh? And so the Germans were then trapped. They could their escape route became trapped, and they couldn't leave Russia, and so they had to go through the Russian winter. Well, virtually no one made it out alive. But I did say this woman's father was at the Battle of Stalingrad. So, what happened? And he said, "This is what happened. He said there was this Czechoslovakian doctor that for some reason was being sent to the front. I don't know, I can't remember exactly the particulars, but anyway, he got sent to the front. He was supposed to be supplied there by the Czechs that were there. The long story short is that he was there in Stalingrad, this Czechoslovakian doctor, and he didn't get the supplies, he didn't get any food, and he was starving to death. He hadn't had anything to eat in 3 weeks. And so he came to this German camp, and the father of this man's wife, he was there, and he saw this man who was obviously just so hungry, and he said, "Hey, come here." He says, "Here, take my food. Take my food. Take it." And so he gave this man his food. And I'm sure, he was hungry too. It was very tough conditions. Not knowing who the man was at all. He didn't know who he was. He just, "Hey, you need it more than I do. Take my food." Then later on in the Battle of Stalingrad, he happened to come across this man, and he was wearing a white coat, and he was very shocked. He said, "What's going on?" And he says, "Well, I'm a doctor." I said, "I didn't know that. Wow." And then this man, who was a Czechoslovakian doctor, said, "You see that cot over there?" He says, Go over there and lie in it. You're sick. You're sick. Go lie in that cot." And the man said, why? He said, do as I say, do as I say. And the man said, I'm not sick. He says, you're sick. Go on that cot. So he had him lie in this cot, and he put a blanket over him like he was a sick person. And then he was had him put on this transport truck that somehow was able to get passage all the way away from the Stalingrad front and made it all the way back to Europe. And ultimately, he made it back to Germany after the war. And that's the father of this man's wife. So this man who gave his food to this starving man, then the doctor said, hey, you saved my life, I'm going to save yours, because he knew that they were surrounded, everyone was going to die. Apparently there was only one way to get out of there. And so he said, I'm a doctor, I'm saying you're sick, and that's my orders. Saved his life. And when he told me this, I got goosebumps. And I still do. I mean, this is such an extraordinary story to just hear from a stranger who's rummaging in a dumpster. And I said, my gosh, you know, isn't this exactly apropos to our situation in the world right now? We're surrounded. We really are surrounded. Just like, you know, Stalingrad, they got encircled. The way out, as I've been saying to everyone, is to lay low. To really lay low. So what happened to this man? Lie down on the cot, you're sick. And that to a soldier who's not sick, you know, they don't want to do that. You know, that's, you just don't do that. But the doctor insisted. Now, in this world, we don't want to lay low. We want to help people. We want to take on challenges. We want to help fix problems, et cetera, et cetera. As a spider is weaving its web in one of these lights, I just noticed, to catch the insects that come here attracted by the light. Interesting, huh? Again, apropos of the world right now. So, to lay low, is really to not engage in the fight. To not engage in the fight. And this is what Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, the Nyingma lineage, Sogchen lineage, the Dharma kings, they're all impressing this upon me with tremendous focus. Don't get involved in any fights. Now, I almost got involved in a fight today with someone on a surf website doing a surf article, the article wasn't really on surfing, it was about on American politics and ripping the president, you know, just like every which way you can possibly rip him, and ripping the American people and everything. And it's just like, wow, it's a European. And I just like, you know, what? I was like, wow. And like, you know, we like to handle our own politics here, you know. We don't like the rest of the world trying to dictate to us. You know, they don't know anything about this country, actually. They think they do. They don't know anything about our problems here. It's like people who don't live in California don't really understand the California drought. Thank God it's over. Thank the atmosphere who brought the moisture from the Pacific Ocean. Really. It's just amazing. But I said, no, I'm not going to comment back. I'm not going to do it. This is what I mean by don't engage in any fights. Absolutely don't engage in any fights. This will be our downfall. I certainly know it's my downfall if I do that. So I have to really err on the side of caution and step back as much as possible from what's going on in the world, because I know my personality, I know my tendencies, I know how my downfall could happen. So I have to, you know, I'm not going to explain to the world exactly how, you know, as far as those who might bring about my downfall, I know, but certainly it's possible. And so I have to avoid that, to lay low. Don't try to play the hero, you see. Playing the hero is absolutely the way to end up as zero in terms of your functionality. It's super dangerous right now. It's maybe the most dangerous time in history, actually. And, you know, I could get into it and explain it in detail how it all works. I don't know if I'll do that here, now, or later, or not at all. I don't know. But I'm taking steps and trying to take more and more steps. Let's put it this way, you have to insulate yourself from anybody who tries to motivate you to be a hero. And there are those who are very expert at that. And you just have to stay away from them because they're so good at it. If you hang out with them, you're going to fall. And I fell back in the 60s and early 70s for sure. Hey, you need to be a hero that we're going down history. Look at all what we're doing. And I don't need to be in the history of this world. I'll be in the history of the Dharma. I already am in the history of the Dharma, part of the Dharma. So part of that history already. And previous lives have already been part of the history of the world. So I don't need to be part of the history of this world at all. So the idea of being a big shot hero to some revolution, some cause, we're always being drafted for some cause by these very clever people, aren't we? And I've already been burned by that most terribly in this life. And so my goal is to not be burned by it again. Okay, otherwise I'm a fool. Burn me once, shame on you. Burn me twice, shame on me. Right? So when I say a silent intensive, I say 1 year silent intensive. Obviously I'm talking. I don't mean silence in terms of saying anything. I mean silence in a more profound way, which would be in terms of action. Because they say action speaks louder than words, right? So when we say silence, we should first apply it to our action, because that's more powerful than words. Be silent in your action, meaning don't take action. Okay, be silent in your action. Now, it's a very scary thing to do. I've noticed that very daring thing to do. And yeah, history will pass you by. Great. But the history of the Dharma won't pass me by. It won't pass you by either, will it? So be part of Dharmic history. And whatever happens to the world is neither here nor there as far as Dharmic history is concerned. Because from the standpoint of the Dharma, there is no world. So there's really no history of the world either, actually. If there isn't a world, how can there be a history of a world that doesn't exist? So really go silent in terms of action. And it's very difficult for young people to get this point. But it's no time to not get it. All right? So you really have to err on the side of caution here and take it to heart from someone who's been through it all and made the mistakes and knows the mistakes. You must not hang out with those who are capable of motivating you into heroic action, taking action in some cause and something. Not that they will or not, but they're capable of it. So you have to err on the side of caution. Don't even hang out with those who are potentially capable of it. Even if they say, oh, they're safe. No, if they're potentially capable of it, don't hang out with them. Stay away. Stay away. Because there are those who are so clever at recruiting that you can't tell them from those who are not so clever. They disguise it so well. You just have to err on the side of caution, and those who are innocent of this will easily forgive you and say, good, you're doing the right thing. It's fine. It'll all come out in the wash, and so we'll know who's who and what's what. That's not a problem. So really keep your distance. Keep your distance in all ways, in all ways. Do a 1 year intensive on silent action. Go silent on your action, on world-based action. This is the best move to make, and it's really essential. So I pray all the time for this, really, and it's extremely difficult for some reason. We are geared in this world in various ways through our habits. And I know I certainly am, to, you know, play the hero role, foolish hero, to be, you know, disposed of as I work for someone else's objectives, right? As I work for the worldly objectives of doubt, the idea of, well, you can be a hero, you know, great hero, you know, that kind of be, go down in history. And, you know, there's so many beguiling ways to entrap us, and they're all used, they're all used. And it's amazing how difficult it is to step away from this. It's just like the tar baby. I can't, you know, so hard to get detached from it. We're just vulnerable. We're just vulnerable. And no argument seems to work very well. We're just vulnerable. So it's best to just stay away and pray that the Dharma kings give you the excuses you need to stay away. And you should give them carte blanche to help you. Which I have done, which I have done. See, people just expect they know your identity and what you're supposed to do with it, and they're completely wrong. They're completely wrong. They have wrong premises, and they just assume that their premises are right, and therefore their reason, logic from that premise must be right, has to be. No, the premise is wrong. The logic following that premise may be correct, but the premise is wrong. So we spend our time looking at the basic premise and looking at it some more and some more and some more and some more. Now, here's an example of blocking occurring. It happened today. So when we pray to be blocked, take it in good grace when you're blocked. So I went to a gas station. I always do push-ups while the vehicle is being filled up. That's how I keep my upper body strong. It's you know, what otherwise I'd just be standing there, the gas pump. So I do push-ups on the metal tubing and the U-shaped tubing at the end of the gas islands. And so I was going to do that today, but there was a guy standing right there. I said, I can't do it. So I'll wait until he leaves. Well, he didn't leave. And finally, I kind of walked over there. So I wondered, what the heck's going on? He kind of smiled at me, and it was real friendly, and said, hey, my van, it's not starting. And I noticed he had his hazard lights on, and he said, yeah, I just got the van from across the street. It's, you know, fixed. Electrical problem is fixed. And but the van, it won't start. So I went to the gas station here and to get gas, it won't start. I said, wow. So I said, okay, let me help him. Let me help him. So I checked the headlights. I tried to start them. They seemed okay. I said, I don't know what's wrong. It can't be the battery because the lights didn't even dim. It's weird. And by that time, my vehicle had filled up. And then somebody arrived from across the street. I guess he called them with a jump starter, and they jump started the van. He goes, oh, okay, it's going now. And they said, well, maybe it's just a loose contact with the battery. And then he was ready to leave. And by that time, I had to leave too because, you know, already filled up. So I didn't get to do any push-ups. And I was kind of like, wow, I really thought I should do those. But then I realized, you know what? That was God blocking me. The whole thing, as soon as I decided not to do the push-ups, the van started and he's ready to leave. But prior to that, no, nothing's working. I got blocked. And what it was is awareness that my shoulders are tired. I've been working out for 4 straight days. It wasn't the right time to do the push-ups. Take a break. Take a day off. Take a day off. But God had to block me because I'm so... disciplined and full of motivation to do as good as I can, I was going to do it no matter what. You see, I'm here, I'm supposed to do this, I got to do it. It's the same thing with the world, right? We're here, we think we have to help out, we got to take action. Not always. it could be very detrimental to us and to others as well. So ask God to block you in every which way that you need to be blocked. Okay, seriously, do this. I know it's kind of scary, but it's also very exhilarating. Now, back to that man whose wife's father was that German soldier at Stalingrad. And he did a favor for somebody. And it came back to him tenfold. So after the man told me the story, I was so grateful for him, because I realized this is God speaking to me here, telling me what to do. You know, you're sick, get in the cot, get covered up. You know, in other words, stop taking part in the battle. So it turns out this man needed a wood-burning stove. I said, what are you looking for? He says, well, what I really need is a wood-burning stove, you know, because it's cold up in the mountains, and you know, I don't know, I have to burn wood for my heat. But my stove, oh, he said, my stove is 120 years old. It's not working anymore. I said, wow, you're 80 and it's 120 years old. That's amazing. And then I said, well, wait a minute. Wait a minute. I know a friend who is trying to get rid of a wood-burning stove, and no one's been able to take it because it's too doggone heavy, and it's just sitting in their yard. And I said, you know, if you'd be willing to take it, I bet you they'd let you have it. I think it's a really, really good one. And so he said, yeah, I'd love to. I'd take it if it's good. Yeah, I will. So I said, okay, follow me. So we drove over to my friend's house. And there was the wood-burning stove. And he looked at it and he says, wow, this is a beauty. This is a really, really nice one. And he says, oh, for sure I'll take it. Yeah. And I asked my friend, is it okay? He says, absolutely, please take it. It's too heavy for any of us to move. And he says, no, I'll get it. I'll get some help here and I will get it. So he got this, you know, very expensive, beautiful wood-burning stove, which he needed. Because I had the grace to talk with him and be nice with to him, and he was so nice to me, and then he told me the story that I realized was really helpful information for me, you know, life-saving kind of information for me. And then I was able to, you know, reciprocate and do something that was really helpful for him. It's so amazing that he just happened to mention that he needed that very thing, and it suddenly clicked, I know where one is. We've been trying to get rid of it for 6 months. I mean, you tell me that wasn't set up by God. And then I get up this morning. Well, let's just say the progress I'm going through is extremely profound. And I get up and look on Facebook, and there's a video by Dion DiMucci called "My Prayer," and it's a beautiful song. And he just completely avoids any activism at all. And he just says, you know, when you're down, don't know what to do, and all this, you know. He says, God, I'm here for you. It's just this beautiful song that he just did there in his home in New York or something, and posted on Facebook. Yeah, he's just a great guy, Dion DiMucci. Really, he's got so much soul. And I just listened to a blues song he sang on YouTube. Oh, my God, he's just tremendous. He's just a tremendous singer, one of the best singers in American history, really. An icon, a beautiful soul, very spiritual soul. And so that just picked me up. I said, wow, he's also saying, just turn to God, okay? Turn to prayer and turn to God. Don't turn to activism and all the stuff that's going on and hatred, okay? Just turn to God for prayer. Perfect message, right? Perfect message. So for me, to lay low is a radical move, a very radical move. And so I'm taking that route, and I'm feeling the shock of it. It's very shocking. It's like you're missing the wave of history. I say, yeah. Go ahead. If you want to surf it, go ahead. I'm going to sit outside for a while and not ride these waves. Now, interesting, because I was thinking about, earlier in the day, I was thinking about surfing Pipeline in Hawaii, North Shore Hawaii, and how would I surf it? And I had this sort of mental idea about it. And I said, you know what I would do? I would go out to the second or third reef. There's three reefs at Pipeline. The inner reef, the first reef, the one farthest in, it's called First Reef. That's where all the good waves happen. And only when it's really big does the second and really huge then the third reef break. So everybody's in at the first reef. And what I felt I was going to do, I'm going to go out to the second and third reef, way out there, and just sit out there and wait. And I might be the only one out there. Maybe there'll be one other out there. And they might be thinking, what is that kook doing out there on the third reef? But I'll let them catch all the waves inside. And then I thought that a huge set comes in and it's going to break on third reef. But what I do is I don't take the first one, because I know that's going to catch all those guys who are inside. It's going to catch them and clean them up. It's a clean-up wave, clean-out wave, where it just cleans the whole lineup out. It pushes them all into shore. It's a white water, you know, they don't make it out, and hits them and pushes them all into shore. And so then when the second and third wave comes, I can catch that wave, and I can ride it in, and there's nobody paddling out, you know, you have to dodge them. There's so many people in the water, you got to, like, surf and dodge all the other surfers. That's really dangerous, actually, because they're already all cleaned out. So I'll be out way outside, catch that wave, and surf it in without any having to dodge anybody. Very interesting. Just consider that. Let all these heroes catch their waves. Not interested in those kind of waves. I'm interested in the really big waves. The dharmic waves, okay. Surfing those waves. Be a charger on those waves. So be like that if you can build your nerve up. Be a little daring. Now, I have a friend who's got advanced cancer, and they're trying to design a specific treatment for him based on all sorts of testing parameters. And, you know, what does he have to lose? This is how I look at it. He might as well just go for it, right? And that's what another relative did, and he beat cancer. He decided, I got nothing to lose. I have to just go for it. Let me just go for it. And his whole attitude changed. So I realize the world right now is like a super advanced cancer, spiritual cancer, you might say. And especially the ones who don't think they have it, the self-righteous ones who think, you know, that they're the ones who have the worst. They're the worst. And so the world is in such bad shape right now. It seems like I'm entrapped. I feel encircled and entrapped with no way out. So what do I have to lose? I don't have anything to lose, really. I might as well take a risk and say, okay, let me lay low and give God the go-ahead permission to block everything that would cause my downfall. And, like, go outside and wait for a big wave, you know, and just say, well, you know what? I have a feeling it's going to come. My time will come. Let the waves of history roll through. I'm not interested in riding those waves. So it's this attitude of you know, I got nothing to lose. If I don't do something that works, I'm going to get pulled down for sure. So I might as well take a bit of a risk. You know, I don't know what's going to happen, but I'm going to do it. So I did that today. I decided, okay, let's go for it. And I don't know what's going to happen. But it feels exhilarating. It feels shocking, but also exhilarating. A year of no action. The year of no action. So you can do, you can, I'm providing you an excuse here to do the intensive of no action. A 1 year silent action intensive. So you can say, well, you're taking this, you could say Tibetan Buddhist intensive, actually. A Padmasambhava intensive, actually. I called in the heavyweight. I've called in the heavyweight. I said, Padmasambhava, this is no time for you to sit it out. We'll call on you. You know, we'll call on you. That's when you call on Padmasambhava, you're going for the strong medicine. You decided, okay, I'll do the trial. Okay, we'll try this experimental medicine here. What do I have to lose? Because Padmasambhava is the guru, the action guru, okay, historically. Is there any other guru in history that's taken the kind of action that he has? I don't know of any. He gets things done. When you call him Padmasambhava, you're going to get action on your behalf. Okay, there's no doubt about it. It's kind of scary. You know, I used to be kind of scared about it. When I first saw Padmasambhava, I said, oh my gosh, this is very scary. Because I saw, you know, that he doesn't mess around. He'll take action. You know, this is the strong medicine. So it's taken, you know, quite some time where I have to get over my jitters about asking, you know, allowing Padmasambhava to help out. I mean, what he did with Tibet is just beyond, you know, anyone's expectations, right? He acts beyond expectations is what he does. He thinks big, you know. He's not into failure either, that is for sure. That's not in his vocabulary. It's not in his mind at all. So when you ask protection from Padmasambhava, you're going to get protection. And your expectations are going to be exceeded in every which way, actually. Now, if you have really advanced stage cancer, you know, you go into a trial, what's your mindset? You're thinking like, well, what do I have to lose? But, you know, I'm probably a goner, you know. Deep down, you're thinking that way. But when you allow Padmasambhava to help you, you realize you're not a goner. It's just the opposite. You realize this is going to work. So imagine if somebody goes into, you know, this really dreadful cancer and they, you know, they decide they're going to take this specialized mixture. What the heck, you know, what I got to lose, I might as well just take it. Just so I said I tried. But what if you realized, right off the bat, you realize this is actually going to work. I'm going to be cured, for sure. And I'm going to go back to my life and I'm going to be better than ever. I am going to be cured. There's no doubt in your mind. Imagine that feeling if someone is in a drastically bad situation who suddenly realized, oh, this for sure is going to work. I have no doubt about it. That would be a pretty amazing feeling, wouldn't it? That's the feeling you get when you call on Padmasambhava. I called on Padmasambhava today and immediately I got this profound feeling. I mean, it's just immediately. Our continuity fear is like shaking. Says, you don't dare call on Padmasambhava, you know. What are you thinking? Yes, just, you don't want to get well, do you? You're not ready to get well, are you? I say, dear continuity fear, thank you for the reminder. But you know what? What have I got to lose? I'm more ready to get well than I am ready to fail again. Okay, let's put it that way. Don't make continuity fear an adversary, okay? It's in it with you. Just like when I was released from this world by all the psychotics, I didn't make an adversary out of them. You know, I said, okay, I'll help you out. I'll do what I can. I'll see, you know, I'll ask the king what can be done for you. I didn't, you know, turn them into adversary. And they weren't my adversary either. They didn't turn me into adversary. They said, we know you can help us. We know you can help us and you will. So we're going to set you free. So continuity fear is not, don't try to turn into an adversary. Be kind and gentle with yourself. It's your own self that's just has this, you know, bias toward what it's familiar with and a bias against what it's not familiar with. And so it gets jittery. So don't say, well, that's the ego. I got a, you know, terrible ego. You're trying to stop me from this. No, no, no. I said, I listen. I said, thank you, thank you. I appreciate you. I know you're reacting to this, and that's fine. And so I take that into account, okay? But I feel very strongly that given the recent progress I've been making, that it'll be okay. And it's worth it because what else are we going to do, right? And so continuity fear then backed off and said, you know, I just said, oh, you know, okay. But I got the jitters. I still have the jitters. And that's continuity fear and shock. Shock is kicking up. Wow. But because I'm so nice to the continuity fear and I don't have an adversarial relationship within myself anymore, there's no conflict within me, very little. I see it for what it is and I just say, okay, I'll back off. If continuity fear gets too strong, I start to notice it and I say, okay, let me go a little slower. And then it eases off like that. So I don't have this inner conflict going on. I have an inner dynamic going on, but it's a positive relationship sort of thing. We understand one another, and we know we're on the same side, and we know what the goal is. We just, you know, one side's, you know, let's go. The other side says, whoa, 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 be careful, like that, accelerator and the brake. But it's you know, I'm driving the car. It's not two people driving the car. There's one. There's one mind driving the car, so there's no conflict here. So my feeling, yeah, is right now it's shock, jitters. I have to be careful. Right now I have to be careful. So again, be compassionate with yourself. Compassion starts with yourself, actually. I wouldn't have talked to that man in the dumpster if I didn't have compassion for myself. You know that? So your kindness to others starts with the compassion that you have for yourself. And so many people have no compassion. They're so harsh towards themselves, no compassion. They just think they're trapped and it's not fair and there's something inside them that's horrible and terrible and, you know, deserves to die and, you know, they're willing to sacrifice to kill that bad self and all this stuff. You know, and so they can't be nice, really compassionate to others. But if you're compassionate to yourself, you'll be compassionate to others. And that's what happened today. I had every reason to chase him away or act rude or haughty or big time him, you know, who's this old man scrounging around in the dumpster, and he shouldn't, it wasn't even his, you know, what's he doing, he's poaching, you know, and it just, hey, I could have said just like, hey, it's our dumpster or something, or, you know, that we don't, you know, we don't allow that here, or what are you doing? But there was none of that. I just walked over and was working on stuff, and I said, hey. I said, you finding good stuff today? And they said, well, I'm finding a few things. I said, well, what are you looking for? Maybe we can, maybe there's something in there. And then I opened the other, helped open it up more. And so I started out in just this totally cheerful, kind, friendly way, you know? I didn't have any agenda with them at all. I just said, you know, you're okay with me, you know? I hope you find something good. I even help you find something good. And he turned out to be this beautiful soul, really. Not what I thought at all. It was so shocking. This man was actually, you know, high degrees and professional. And he just was, you know, this was just his thing in retirement. I guess he's just looking for some things. He's looking for some firewood, too. Cheap firewood that maybe were thrown away or something. And such a nice man. So intelligent. You know, and clear-minded, and with a very nice spirit. An 80-year-old, you come from a better generation, right? He was, must have been a boy in World War II, born in, what, 19-something, 33 or something, or 36. Yeah, 1936. So he was a boy in when World War II got started, 41, 5 to 10 years old. So he's old school. He's this wonderful old school, but so kind and friendly and smiling and in such great health, you know. And I just like, wow, how amazing, how amazing. So compassion, you start with yourself by recognizing continuity fear is your problem. And you're not trying to trip yourself up. You're just scared. You're not evil. You're not wicked. You just are biased, you know, away from what you don't know, what's unfamiliar. You're biased against that. You want to stick with what you're familiar with is all. That's the only problem we have. It's the only problem we have. And when we try to go towards what we're not familiar with, we get continuity fear. We get these jitters, continuity jitters, like, oh my gosh, I don't know what's going to happen. Just like when I'm driving down a mountain road, I did one today. I've never been on this road before. It was, wow, what a trip that was. I was just like, up winding, narrow road along these canyons and the mountainside with rivers and cataracts flowing down and mudslides everywhere. It was beautiful, just beautiful. But also, yeah, my heart was almost in my throat. I said, "My gosh, what happens to this road? I don't know. Some places got very narrow. There was water flowing all over the road and mud." I was like, "Oh gosh!" But it was so incredibly scenic, deep forest kind of place. And so, but coming back down the road, it's a piece of cake. Because I was already familiar with it. I said, no, everything's fine on this road, not a problem. So you see, so when you're going towards something you're not used to, you're not sure, you're really going to have the jitters. But when you find out what it's really about, then it's like, oh, it's not a problem. So that's evaporated, my continuity fear was evaporated for that road. Now next time I said, oh, it's a piece of cake, nothing to worry about. Except tomorrow when the next storm arrives, which I won't be going up that road. No way. The hillsides are just melting, really. The mountains are just melting. It's not granite. It's not volcanic or metamorphic rock. It's sedimentary rock, the mountains, pushed up from the sea. And it's not strong. And it's just falling apart. I mean, the mountains are just crumbling. Really, they are. The water is so muddy from all the loose sedimentary sediment, you know, that's just getting so wet, it just kind of dissolves in the water. There are some hills in California, the Alabama Hills, are like 4 billion years old, super, super hard rock. But these hills, Santa Cruz Mountains, they're melting down fast. another mudslide on Highway 17. We're getting mudslide in this next storm that's supposed to hit this evening pretty soon. We'll see how much it dumps. It could dump a lot of rain up there again. Familiarity is so important. It's the key. As soon as you realize that familiarity is your problem, as soon as you realize that, you will be a different person. You will have a different relationship. You'll have a different inner feeling. You'll realize conflict. You will feel a changed feeling within you. You will feel a different feeling within you. As soon as you realize your only problem is familiarity and the continuity jitters that come with that, as you keep turning back towards certainty, you get these continuity fear, continuity jitters, which kind of shock you. Your expectations have been melting down because you thought your future is based on doubt, and now you say, "Oh, I think it's going to be based on certainty." And you go, "Whoa, that changes everything, doesn't it?" Scary. So the road seems kind of scary, but as soon as you realize that's your problem and nothing else, then you start having this compassion for yourself. And your path becomes a compassionate path. And you start doing the right thing for yourself. You start making the right decisions. And you say, "I'm going to do this for myself because I know this is helpful." And you feel you deserve to get well because you're not bad. You're not bad. No one is bad. They just have continuity fear. The ones that have a really bad continuity fear, they might seem to be pretty nasty. You might know a few of those, right? It's just really severe continuity fear, and they don't recognize it. And so they think that there's some part of them that's really evil and bad and terrible, and they feel so ashamed and guilty about it, and they don't know what to do about it, and they're just lost souls, you know? And just to set the example for them. And have compassion on yourself because it's all you. There's not some second self within you. There's no ego within you, really. It's all just you and your continuity fears. You and your bias of familiarity. You want to stick with what's familiar. That's all you. There's nothing else there, just you. And so be compassionate with yourself. Sometimes I look in the mirror, like after taping these videos, and I look at the mirror and I say, I don't know who that is, I've never seen them before, but I sure like them a lot. I like them a lot better than the last time whoever that is, I like it a lot better. I like this reflection in the mirror a lot better than I liked the reflection in the mirror a couple days ago. And I say, "Wow, I don't know what this reflection is, but I really like it. This is what I'm experiencing now, really. I look at the mirror like, oh my gosh, what is that?" And I'm seeing compassion shining in the mirror back at me. And I'm saying, "What is that? Never seen that before." I don't really recognize it as myself, really, so much. I'm saying that I don't know who that is exactly, but they're a really nice person. I like them. And maybe I can get used to them, you know, that kind of thing. It's funny looking in the mirror. Mirrors are weird, aren't they? Remember, I mean, just think back in history when before there were mirrors, nobody knew what they looked like. I guess they could look in like a clear pond or something, and what's that? But they had to kind of rely on other people's reactions, and you can't see your own face, can you? You know, not really. So it must have been really weird for people to have the first mirrors and like look in a mirror and say, you know, "Oh my gosh, well, who's that? What's that?" We're still doing that. What's that? So I'm noticing, you know, big changes of that are just, I said, "Wow, thanks to the Dharma Kings, the Holy Spirit and the Dharma Kings. Grace of God teaching me, you know, compassion and why to have compassion and recognition, skillful practice, right advice. But it's available for everyone. But as long as we're fighting ourselves, we won't pay attention, at least not enough attention. We'll keep thinking, oh, I need to devise, how do I defeat this horrible ego, you know, this terrible ego, I have some evil self, or there's something trying to subvert me, so it's a terrible self. No, there's no such thing like that. It's our own dear self, it's our own dear mind. It's just we got the jitters because we're so scared of certainty. We think it's an abyss. We wouldn't know how to function. We wouldn't know how to act, what our future would be, what, you know, with certainty. We're so used to believing, to wishing in doubt, actually. We're just wishing for doubt. And so our expectations are, in fact, all expectations really are based on doubt. In reality, we don't need expectations. We don't need them at all, actually. So we're really afraid of having no expectations. Oh my God, what's going to happen when I have no expectations? Then we think that's no life. I don't want to have a life. We're so used to the believing in expectations, because expectations are always doubt-based in terms of we're expecting the time to start, really. We're expecting this moment to not be this moment. In other words, we're expecting time to start and doubt to then begin. So we're so used to expecting time and doubt to start that we think that's our life. And without any expectations at all, we wouldn't have life, we think. And so this is what we're really scared about. But I've tried to live my life without expectations. Jesus recommends this, very, very important. He says, Ramana too, don't plan. He says, Ramana said, the truly good person doesn't plan for the future at all. He says, really, that's true. And I have to say, I don't plan. Hardly at all. I know it's intensive. I've been given this advice to do this intensive, but I didn't plan it, and I don't have. I just don't plan my life, or my days, or my years. Or I don't. My calendar's nothing on my calendar. I don't plan the next minute, really. I don't. I just trust it. So I live largely without any plans at all. And I pretty much go by spur of the moment. And just from the advice of the Holy Spirit says, hey, do this. Well, how would you like to do this right now? And I say, well, sure, why not? Let's do it. I'm like that. But other than that, I try not to think about the future. I try not to have expectations, okay, which is really helpful. Jesus says that's super helpful. All the Dharma Kings recommend this. Because reality doesn't have any expectations for itself. It's just freedom. And so, whatever it is we want to experience, that's what we experience spontaneously, simultaneously. But we're completely in it, experiencing it, without putting any expectations on it. Well, this has to lead to something else. No, it doesn't have to lead to something else. See, that then is the belief in process and time, actually. So we don't, in reality, doesn't doubt the moment is fully present. And fully, the allness is there each moment. The full richness of reality is present every moment. So there's no reason to try and expect something other than that in the moment. No, don't lay any expectations on the moment. So I really live that way already. It's just how I am. Somehow, grace of God has helped school me in that way. I don't try to force it, but you know, whatever arises, let it arise. Here comes the front of this storm. You can hear the wind starting to pick up before the front rain arrives. The first is the pressure system shift, and you get the wind. See, I don't know what I'm going to do next. I don't even know what I'm going to say next. Doesn't seem to bother me. I think I'm more inspired, more creative, live a better life that way, actually. Although, it's a little, you know, of course it's a little jittery in today. If you're living in a cave and eating berries, and you live in a, you know, place with all these fruits and nuts and berries, you just pick what you want to eat, well, you don't need to plan the future. Whereas you live in a place where nobody can afford to live anyway, and everything is skyrocketing as far as money and price, everything, it's just like, wow. Okay, you know, turn over the Dharma Kings. You know, they told me don't plan for the future. Okay, I'll keep doing it, but keep not, you know, not planning. But yeah, that's a interesting discipline. That man in the dumpster, he said, "Call me sometime. Call me sometime." I said, "Well, you never know. You never know." He has a huge family. Interesting, huh? So many children and then so many grandchildren. And he says, boy, I have a lot of help. Whatever I need to do, I can get help from everybody. Kind of sounds like Baba Samava, doesn't it? Baba Samava can call on. How many helpers can Baba Samava call on? You kidding? You can call upon the entirety of Tibetan Buddhism. The entirety of it. And those that even came before him. I mean, who can't he call upon, basically, you know? Holy cow. I mean, he bound by oath all of these different entities, dimensional, subtle entities. He just, you know, he just... So, interesting corollary here. This man saying he has so much help he can call upon. I said, you can't lift that thing. It's way too heavy. He says, don't worry. I got so much help. I always can get all the help that I need. So I've got it. I was really worried about it. And he says, no, I'm used to lifting heavy stuff. Don't worry. So in other words, there's something super, super heavy. I knew how heavy it was. I said, it's crazy. You need four people to lift that for sure. So heavy. And he actually moved it a bit. I said, wow, you're strong. I can't move that thing. He could. And he said, no problem. Piece of cake. We got it. So in other words, somebody who can easily take care of very heavy situations, easy to call on, very confident, easy to call on help. No problem whatsoever. And so I just trust him. I say, okay, man, it's in your hands. I trust you. You tell me you got help. Okay, I'll leave it in your hands. I know you'll get it. And I just left it at that. I trusted him. You know, he gave me signs that showed me he can back up his talk. Because he told me, I've lifted many of them. I've gotten many of them before. Give them to his children. He gives them to his children, people who need them. And so he's used to dealing with these really heavy cast iron wood stoves. And he showed me with the stove. I see, oh, this guy absolutely knows what he's doing. No doubt about it. So my doubts were gone, and I could proceed with my day. Go into the mountains and go through that amazing experience. It's pretty shocking. You go from the suburbs, Silicon Valley suburbs, to within 20 minutes to half an hour, you think you could be in any forest in the world. I mean, the redwood forest is dark and deep, right? And mossy, and you go into a different world just that quickly. Coastal redwood forests. Boom, you're just suddenly in them. And you're like, wow, it's like another world. And then coming out of them, just as quickly, boom, you're back on the freeway. And it's like you're back in another world like that. It's pretty amazing. And then you got the beach there, too. You can go to the beach, which is why people like this area. You have the bay, the city, the suburbs. Central Valley is, you know, it's over the mountain range there. But then you've got, you know, the redwood forests, and then you got the ocean. So, depending on your mood, a lot of people love hiking through the mountains. Some people, love the beach, and some love doing both. And speaking of taking action, there are these crazy mountain bikers riding up this road, and it's still raining, and the wind is, I mean, the amount of water is just pouring off of these trees. They're saturated. Everything's saturated, and the road is pouring with water all over the road. It's just streaming water everywhere, mud. And here they are climbing this road, in short sleeves, in biker shorts. It's like, come on, man. Can't you even take one day off? Yeah, like that. Wouldn't it be smart to take just one day off? They can't. They couldn't. They can't. Gotta ride the bike. That's compulsive. That's compulsive. And that's the problem with this world. Overconfident, very overconfident, very compulsive, driven to action. And I said, you know what? I think I would just wait until this next storm's over. Go riding on the weekend. You can't even stay off your bike for 1 or 2 days. No, it's compulsive. I just shook my head, I says, wow. Because they kind of looked, one of the guys looked at me, I was taping him. He's like, huh? Those mountain bikers are very compulsive action addicts, actually. So we don't want to be like that. We want to, when things get too nasty, we say, you know what? Let's wait till it calms down. And we'll sort it out then. Global politics right now. Let it sort itself out right now. Everything has shifted, and we're not sure who the players really are and what's really happening. And it's just a great time to say, you know what? It's too stormy right now, and let's just work on pure awareness, abiding in the recognition of pure awareness, which is rootless. What is pure awareness rooted in? No, it's the primal base. It's not rooted in anything. It's rooted in its own presence. And that's it. It's rootless. Just pure presence. Rootless pure presence, not rooted in anything at all. And as such, also, nothing can take root in pure presence either. Pure awareness. Pure awareness. Everything is like a reflection, ornamentation. Everything is like ornamentation. But it, nothing is rooted, doesn't have grow roots into pure awareness. It's being perfectly reflected each moment. So pure awareness is a moment by moment presence. It is not a rooted presence. There's not stuff growing in it. Everything is arising is like a reflection in pure presence. Each moment, it's totally, perfectly being reflected by pure presence. So everything you see is perfect. It's a perfect reflection from pure awareness, the mirror of pure awareness. And it's totally unrooted. Everything is just like an emanation, a reflection of pure awareness in the now, and that's all it is. That's all it is. Each moment, that's all anything is and everything. There's no rootedness at all. Nothing is rooted. Everything is free. Each moment, it's just this pure reflection. So everything is pure just as it is, actually. Everything is already pure and perfect just as it is. And we're just wishing that it isn't, is all. And we're just trying to pay attention to our wishes. And we're not really looking and not really feeling what's actually present in the moment. So whatever, the bottle, whatever you're seeing, that's a perfect reflection of your desire. That's what you want to see. And we don't think that because we're not aware of the presence of pure awareness. You can't experience anything without experiencing the pure awareness, because that's what you're seeing. You're seeing pure awareness ornamenting itself in the now, in the moment, and it's always a pure reflection, a perfect reflection of our desires, of what we want to see, experience. So nothing is corrupted. Nothing is stained. Everything is primordially pure right now. And there's nothing we need to do to make it that way. It's always that way. So we could focus on this. And when we get a wow reaction, we might just put the hand up like, I don't want to talk up. It's a wow reaction. Christians do that service. They raise their hand when they're in the Holy Ghost. It's just, they put their hand up, you know. And they let everyone know in there that they're being moved by the Holy Ghost right now. Wow. And that helps others. It's a very, very good habit. Very, very good. When you're in the wow, I just went into the wow so strongly there, just, you know. Of course, on your arm, I might get tired. You can just, like this, just. And people then know not to bother you. Don't bother you. When someone's in the Holy Ghost, nobody bothers them or asks them anything, right? They understand. And they say, great. And that helps others get into it. I was looking at Rama Maharshi's pictures yesterday, and wow, what an experience. I just burst out laughing. I suddenly saw the twinkle in his eye, and I saw him completely different than I have ever seen him before. And I saw this wonderful, shining, laughing quality of him. I'd never seen that before, and I just burst out laughing, and I couldn't stop laughing. It was spiritual laughter. I had to laugh. Now he makes me laugh so much. Just never experienced that before. I was always kind of like, oh my God, he's so intense, he's so intense. No. That's just the body. That's just the slight covering of the world. Rama is actually very, very, has a very laughing, wonderfully laughing, humorous spirit. And he let me see that as a big breakthrough. He's not some shriveled, serious ascetic, you know. He just radiates bliss and, you know, stillness of pure awareness. Unrootedness, the unrooted stillness of pure awareness is just absolutely empty. It's the emptiness, the pure emptiness. The awareness is like pure emptiness. It's the Buddhist term, emptiness. The primal ground of our experiencing is pure emptiness. No qualities. It's empty of everything. It's like a perfect mirror that just reflects our desires back to us perfectly, because it's not tainting it with any qualities of its own. So it's the absence of all qualities, you might say, that you might call that God. God emptied itself perfectly so it could be this mirror for all its creativity to be reflected beautifully in experience like that. And so Ramana's experiencing this perfect emptiness. But he's also experiencing the great bliss. So he's supremely blissful and happy. And he had a great sense of humor. He would burst out laughing. And he's trying to contain his laughter. He's trying to just... But you could see he's twinkling, he's looking at you, and he has this inner smile. I saw his inner smile past the body. I saw past the body, and I saw his inner smile, Ramaharshi's inner smile. And boom, it really just changed my perspective so much. My whole mood just shifted from that. His helpfulness has been augmented in such a, in that way. Just as I recently seen Sri Sri Anandamayi Maharaj, the inner bliss that she has, just this, her spirit seeing past the body, and just I can feel it. It's like the love, you know. It's just this beautiful love that she just feels for in every direction, for everything, just unopposed, you know, just this. I can feel that. I can feel it. I'm looking past the body. I get that feeling, you know. So that's all. It's all good. Darshan, really, of the gurus is to look past the body and feel the inner quality that they have, to feel that inner quality and relate to that. Don't relate to the mere mask, you know, physical body, the mask. And the gurus, the inner quality shines through. The body doesn't really mask it very much. So that's why you can really pick up on the inner qualities of these Dharma kings so beautifully. Ah, frog's still there. Awesome. So we're just waiting on the storm. I'm pretty interested to see how it's going to be after this storm. I saw mostly emergency vehicles in the mountains. So many police, cleanup crews, and, you know, repair crews of every type, emergency response vehicles. Just that's about all there was up there. Man, they're busy right now. It's mayhem up there in the mountains. And it may be worse after, you know, come Friday. So we're just getting this miracle month, really, of rain. It's been a miracle month of rain. And we're going to get even some more next week. Thank God for it. A miracle month of rain, which has knocked out the drought, which we thought would never be knocked out. People are saying, nah, it's a 1,000-year drought, you know, or it's never going to be knocked out. You know, we're doomed. Well, it's knocked out for now. And we'll stay knocked out for a while with that snowpack we have. It's epic. Epic snowpack. And getting more all the time. So, yeah. Reservoirs are going to be full. And they should build some more reservoirs. Seriously. They're into recycling brackish water now. That's the next big thing. Why not build some more reservoirs? Oh, you can't do that. Well, then have less people here. I mean, come on, do something. We'd love everybody to come to California, but you know what? We only got so much water. It's really, California's really kind of a desert. But the coastal mountains historically get water. Obviously, yes, the redwood trees are there, so they keep getting water. Some of them are thousands of years old. The sequoias too. But LA is a desert. Let's face it. And some say it's still a desert. I don't know. I haven't spent much time in LA, to tell you the truth. I'd like to, actually, just to see what it's like. I mean, it's like, what, 72 suburbs in search of a city? It'd be kind of cool to hang out in LA for a while. Some people like it. It's, as I say, LA is not a place, it's a state of mind. It really is a state of mind. And there's a lot of people down there, that is for sure. If you want to see a big city, just try driving, just get in the middle of LA, then try driving out of LA. And, you know, eventually you start getting spooked. Are we out yet? Are we out yet? And you look and you say, my gosh, there's another freeway exits and they're going to, I see all these buildings and houses and suburbs. And you start to wonder if you're ever going to get out of LA, actually. I mean, LA goes almost all the way to Palm Springs. I mean, it's crazy. It takes, yeah, you can't believe it, how big, how far the suburbs go. They seem to never stop. And then finally, almost as you get to close to Palm Springs, there's a little break. the terrain is so severe there, they haven't built on it yet. And then you know you're going to go down into the desert. Elevation goes down and you go through the sort of a mountain, an area pass kind of area. And finally you've left LA behind. You breathe a big sigh of relief and say, wow, release too. And wow, finally out of that place, man. It just, it wears you down. Because it all looks kind of the same. You know, it's just kind of, it's not so pleasant driving through all this arroyos and barrancas and dry land and just houses just kind of stacked up everywhere. Parts of houses stacked up, you know, big box stores just everywhere. Car dealerships everywhere. So many cars, millions of cars everywhere. And you're just like, I kind of like to get out of here, please. So once if you live in the middle of LA, you know, you might not get out of LA too much. You're just, it becomes its own world, actually. But the people are nice. I think they drive really well. I've always found them to be very, very friendly and nice people. And because they think they're supposed to be happy. They live in LA, they got to be happy. Everyone's happy here. So everyone walks around smiling and like, I'm in LA, that's really cool. Because a lot of them are from, you know, mid other parts of the country or world. And they're like, I made it to LA. I mean, that's like, you know, their Shambhala or something. So they're happy. They said, man, I'm happy I'm here. And, you know, the Los Angeles, what do you call them? It'll come, the word. When I worked at a place that was kind of midway between Northern California and Southern California, got tourists, a tourist place. Easy to spot the Northern Californians, easy to spot the people from LA. Easy. You could always tell. People from LA were always happy, always smiling. Here I am, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Friendly. And the ones from Northern California were always very sharp and aloof. Like, they had that attitude, not friendly at all. Kind of like, who are you? I don't need to talk to you, do I? kind of like that. Are you someone I'm supposed to be talking with? I don't think so. LA, I say, hey, how are you? Nice place, Chevy. I love it, you know. I say, where are you from? Well, we're from Los Angeles. We just come up for the day, you know. Just enjoy it. It's a really beautiful place here, isn't it? You know, I say, ah, I just love it here. And I say, well, yeah, you know, how are you today? You know, they're just so congenial kind of that way. And of course, you know, they feel that when you're in LA, they feel like they're in showbiz, basically. Like they're kind of like extras in some big movie that's happening. The movie, you know, Los Angeles, the movie is happening. And they're all extras in this great movie that's happening. And that's the kind of their attitude. So they're always kind of like on camera, you know. So you don't know if it's really what their persona is really that way or they're on camera and saying, you know, I'm getting my, you know, I gotta be great on camera here. I mean, that's I want to be part of it all, you know. It really, they act like they're on camera all the time. It's amazing. So they have to, you know, play the role of, oh, you're on camera too. So like, what's my role with you? What are our lines? And they kind of like, I hope, like, you know, I hope I do my lines right. And what are your lines? And let's do this part good. You know, they live that way. So as you talk with them, you kind of feel like, are we in a movie or something? And am I doing my lines right? And are they waiting for my cues? And kind of like it's really weird. It's a little weird. That's why they call it La La Land, you know. but it does make you feel like you're a nice person because they don't want to flub the scene, so they treat it like, you know, you're part of the movie too and you're important too. Because they're always shooting movies in Los Angeles area, so there's so film crews are everywhere, movies and everything it is. So they're so used to, like, hey, you know, walking down the street, oh, they're filming that movie, and I might be, you know, part of it, walking, you know, pedestrians walking through, whatever. And that spider's just sipping around now. My gosh, they go so fast, it's ridiculous. It's like the internet or something. They have some like web internet here. Maybe that's what I call it, the World Wide Web. My gosh. Weird. It looks like a digital printer. Yeah. Like that back and forth. Just like it's electronic or something. I wouldn't be surprised if insects are just little electronic devices, actually. Bioelectronic devices. The problem, the danger of Los Angeles is you go down there and they look at you like maybe a lot of them also think they're producers. And they say, you know what? I think you'd be really good in my movie. I'm going to cast you as this. And before you know it, you know, you're in their movie and they're the producers. Interesting. But I would say, you know, I'd love to be in your movie, but I'm in Padmasambhava's movie. He's like the super producer, super heavyweight producer, A-list producer, you know, has got nothing but hits, you know, has a vast resume of hit movies, you know, big hits. Bafo cash box, you know, wow. And then you say, oh, that's great, yeah, yeah. You got to look at it this way. I mean, you get caught up in other people's movies, you know. It's a dangerous thing. I think I've been caught up in other people's movies my whole life, actually, tell you the truth. Both my parents were from Los Angeles, you know, yeah. They were big movie people. My dad was a movie star. And we're very much into the whole movie scene, actually. The culture, the movie culture there. Absolutely. They, go to the movies all the time. That's what everybody did. I mean, they felt that they're, part of it all when you're down there. It really gets into you. Interesting stuff. The big premieres are always going on. Let's go to this big premiere. It's a big event. The red carpet's there. The stars are there. It's a big deal. You get to see the stars down there at the premieres, right? Everybody shows up. The media is all there. And all the fans are screaming. Oh, they're so and so. Oh my gosh. I can't believe it. You're there. I see the stars there, and that's the culture, part of it. Part of it, that's Hollywood culture, but it permeates everywhere, kind of. Except when you go out in the boondocks, the suburbs, certain suburbs, you get out to go to the gas station and you say, oh, you look around and say, you know what? I think, why don't we go to some other gas station? I don't think we're in America anymore. What is it? It gets pretty intense. Different cultures, it's their place. It's their place. It's their territory. And you get this feeling like, you better not wander. Even if the gas stations is their territory, and you don't belong in their territory. So I don't think I'm in Kansas anymore. Oops. You better watch yourself, I mean, you don't want to step on any toes. That's for sure. Tough places. Compassion travels well. Compassion travels well. But you can also feel when you're making people uncomfortable. It's best to move on. Just because who, color of your skin or your race or who you are, something you're making people feel uncomfortable. Just say, let's move on. Or your social standing or whatever. You just don't fit. You don't fit in there at all. Then we went through the rich part of LA last time I was there. I'd never seen it before. It's like, oh my gosh, everybody has incredible swimming pools and landscape swimming pools, and just, I mean, they're just living this so dream life. Everything, every day is a pool party. Seriously, I mean, they really do have constant entertainment around the swimming pool, and their kitchen opens up into a big patio with the pool and the lawn and the rocks and waterfalls, and they just are in, real super casual attire. They feel like they jump in the pool just about any time. It's just, sandals. It's just the whole LA thing, like, and they're just so like, they're the beautiful people. We're the beautiful people. And it really is La La Land like that. It's a little strange. Very nice people. They're like, super nice. But hey, come on over and let's go swimming. But then I noticed, like, but they're a little too beautiful. And they're in a movie. They've got all this plastic surgery, all these cosmetic procedures. They're just, too posed. They're like actresses and actors, actually. And they think they're in a movie, a big movie. And they're, they're producing the movie in their yard, their house, their houses, and everything is just so, it's just, it's that way. It's amazing. I had to excuse myself there. Excuse, God could give me an excuse, and I had to go back to the hotel, and they said, oh, you're leaving? I said, I'm so sorry. Oh my gosh. So I avoided all that. And I said, I don't want to be in that movie, actually. I don't want to be in anyone's movie except the Dharma King's movie. So look out, be careful whose movie you're in, actually. Whose movie are you in? It's a good question to ask yourself. Whose movie are you in? New York's another area where where more is there's the business, but whose business, whose business are you working for? What business are you in, kind of thing. There's a lot of showbiz there too. It's that whole area, people tend to have this sort of mentality like that. You're in my movie, you're in my business. It's a little, it's just intense. I've been to New York when I was a lot younger. It's pretty amazing. What product are you selling? Or what product can I sell you? What deal can we do? So you're just this, you're this someone who's there as to fit into their business and deals and marketing and that kind of thing. It's that whirl, the big city whirl. You're not really seen as an individual, a dharmic individual, or anything like that, really. You can kind of lose your identity there pretty easily, actually. I always say that Brooklynites feel that they're America, and everybody's just in living in their America, and they know how you should live. Seriously, there's so much cultural influence has come out of Brooklyn and New York in general, but feeling like, we know what America really is, and it's us. And so we'll help you be good Americans. It's our job. It's your job to follow our advice, the Brooklynites and the New Yorkers. You can be very much that way. It's very, very amazing. The Brooklyn, they feel that, that's America. That's America. So it's Americana, and you got to be careful not to get caught up in that a vision of New Yorkers or Brooklynites, etc. That this is how things should be. They're not malicious about it. It's just the culture and where it is and its history and everything. It's just they just believe that that's true. It's true. It's like a truism. How could it not be? We're the most wonderful people there ever was. So we're going to spread our wonderfulness everywhere, and let us help you realize how wonderful we are. So every place in the world has this weirdness, kind of this spin to it, right? It really does. Coachella Valley, it's like if you're there, something might be something wrong with you. Like, especially in summer, it's like, what are you doing here? We're never here. We got a house here, but we're never here. Maybe they go for 2 weeks out of the year, but the rest of the time, I talked to a real estate agent down there, and he said, "Well, the neighborhood here." I said, "What about that house and this house, your neighbors and stuff?" They said, "Well, they're never here. You might see them like 2 weeks out of the year, but that's about it." He said, "Yeah, no, there's hardly anybody here. Most people, these are second or third homes, and they just come for a short time, and that's it." Beautiful, beautiful place. I said, "So if you'd like," he said, "if you were living here, you'd be like one of the few people that actually live here year round. Most, hardly anybody lives here year round." So the spin there is like, "What are you doing here? Why are you here?" That's a pretty weird spin, isn't it? "Well, why are you here? You're not supposed to be here." But I like it when there's nobody there. It's great. There's nobody here. But it's so beautiful. So you can be a bit eccentric and say, "Ah, I love you, palm tree. Look how awesome you are. There's nobody around," to say you're not supposed to do that. Or talk to the trees, or talk to the beauty and the stillness, and say, "Oh my gosh, so awesome! let me just stop here, let me just sit down here. There's nobody there to even have any take on you, even, really, except in spring where it's like inundated. It's inundated. But come May, you know, everybody leaves. Everybody's poof. And then from May through December, it's pretty doggone quiet. Nothing but the crickets or the cicadas, whatever is buzzing there. A lot of insects buzzing, which is nice. I like that. At least somebody's here. The insects are buzzing. The birds are still flying around. Nice to see the birds, but not so many people. Because it's hot, hot, hot. Really, really hot. Yeah, we're just here, just kind of mellowing out from the Imaho. By the way, Imaho is this famous Tibetan term. I didn't know what it meant, and I still looked up the meaning, and it means like, oh, so marvelous. Like, kind of like our just what I'm experiencing and seeing is so marvelous and so rewarding. It's just, you know, it's like, wow. And I realized Imaho, which they usually say when they start their teaching, it's just Imaho, like I have something so wowish to share with you here. Let's get in this mood of wowishness. That's exactly the same as wow. I mean, we're talking about the same thing. As I say, you know, wow, they say Imaho. So we're on the same page. Really, we are. It's amazing. It's amazing. It's same connotation, really. Wow, what I'm about to share with you is so wowish. Let's get in this mood. We are in the wow mood now. And this is what you do in teaching on the Dharma, on the path. You have to put yourself in this wow mood. We're in this intense wow mood here. As the Tibetans say, that the space that they're in is now special space. It's wow space. It's Imaho space. It's extraordinary. We're in sort of this extraordinary ineffableness, this wowness, as I say. We're just in the wowness of it all right here, right now. And it's not anything in particular. It's not a literal ambience or things or anything. It's the vibe, as we might call it here, the vibe. There's just this vibe of wow. Full stop in the wow, as we call it, that vibe, Imaho vibe. Full stop in the wow vibe. So we're doing the practice right. You know, that maybe that's why Longchenpa says, hey, I yeah. Lot to like here. So it's like very familiar territory. We're in very familiar territory, actually. The way we practice is very, very high type of practice, actually, that Tibetan Buddhists would probably easily recognize and say, wow, this is Dzogchen, really. High Dzogchen practice in a certain way. Not fixating. You know, Longchenpa, well, he's helped this practice, develop this practice, actually. He's been helping out for at least 6 years. Who knows before that, actually. So the whole Dzogchenists and Nyingma masters and Tibetan Buddhism, they may have been helping me my whole life. I don't know. I've been sort of vaguely aware. As the diaspora happened in 59, I was 3 years old, but it permeated and trickled through. Certainly, especially in the Bay Area, you know, there was this hum, buzz of Tibetan Buddhism. It would show up, you know, in magazines and periodicals and books and all sorts of ways. It kind of bumped into it quite a bit here and there. And friends and so we have a friend that hosted a Tibetan who was part of was very close to the Dalai Lama, the family. I mean, they were very relative or something. The Dalai Lama, they hosted them. I mean, so there's it's been sort of in the background, but it's been there. And of course, in the 70s, the 80s, the Tibetan Buddhist teachings were, very, very kind of a lot of buzz about it going on, spiritual buzz. I miss the spiritual buzz. I really do. That we had in the 60s and 70s. It was just people were talking, people were sharing, people were excited. I look at this book I got. They want everybody to know this was so fantastic. I mean, we were excited. We thought that, finally we're getting somewhere. And we were right. We were finally getting somewhere. So I think the excitement was justified. Yeah, I missed that excitement. Those were really, but it was too much. It was just too much. We couldn't sort it out. We just, oh, wait a minute. There's just so much stuff going on. At least it settled down and it allowed us to really dig in and make, super progress. So, but those times were really so compelling because every day you hear a new teacher. Just they were streaming into the West, and the Zen teachers and the Tibetan Buddhist teachers and the Hindu teachers and all sorts of new teachers from all around the world popping up all over the place and constantly new books. And then you think, maybe this is it. This is what I'm waiting for. This is it. And we were still naive and hopeful and ingenue, ingenues in terms of just like, well, no, just genuinely fresh, naive, believing in it. Really believing in it and trusting in it. So those were amazing times. Unfortunately, we got burned so badly, once burned, twice shy, that unfortunately we've become, very shy about it now. Which isn't a bad thing right now to be overcautious, but, latch onto a Dharma king because you can trust them. This is my advice. I love all the teachers, the whole spiritual scene, but when things get really dicey, my advice is to latch onto a Dharma king, okay? Or multiple. I mean, really, just say, you know what, teacher, my teacher, I love what you're doing, but right now I want to go with a sure thing. I want to err on the side of caution. Nothing personal, but I just feel like, I want to go to the very top right now and ask for help, because let's get all the help. Let's get the best help possible right now. The best help, best possible help, is what we have a right to have. And I think any teacher, legitimate teacher, would welcome that and encourage it. I don't hear teachers doing that. I don't quite understand it. They should be encouraging that right now. So absolutely. Supplement whatever I'm doing, supplement it with the Dharma kings. Pray for their help. Petition them. Absolutely. Are you kidding? Get as much help as possible right now, the best help as possible. So let's not pull some spiritual ego trip on anybody and say, no, you got to get help from me. Hey, say, hey, get help from the top. Because of course everyone's goal is let's make it through, let's make it through, let's succeed, let's get into the spirit of abidance, where we realize that it's seamless. The fact that nothing is rooted is a seamless recognition. It's a totally seamless recognition. There's, since nothing at all is rooted, where could you draw a line or a seam? There isn't anywhere you can draw a line or a seam. Everything is just rootlessness. Rootless ornamentation of rootless pure awareness. Everything is just like floating. There's no roots at all. The floating jewel lines citadel, like Longchenpa calls it, of the beautiful ornamentation of pure spaciousness. It's just all spontaneous, simultaneous in the now, without any roots ever. No roots being laid down anywhere. So we can abide in no seams. It's seamless. We can abide in that seamless recognition. It's called the spirit of abidance. To have the spirit of abidance, to see that constantly. We can do that. We can do that. And that should be our goal, because right now, everybody's going to try and latch on to somebody. So you better latch onto a Dharma King. It's safe. You know, who knows what's out there as far as when you, everybody's desperate, who knows what comes out of the woodwork, right? And these are desperate times. So recognize the times are desperate and go to the sure thing. Go to the sure thing. Don't mess around with anything that's not the sure thing at this point right now. Seriously, just cut off everything else, really. If you want to. Well, I don't cut off everything. I still stay in touch with those who are really, I can tell they're very mature and responsible, and they're not, you know, overly enthusiastic, and then, you know, I stay in touch, absolutely. But make sure that you put the Dharma Kings first, and that you're actively petitioning them and accepting their help right now, because you're in a state of, we're all in a state of desperation, actually, in various ways. And if we don't get the help we need, we're going to keep looking. And if we don't go to the Dharma Kings, we may not get the help we need, and then we'll be looking somewhere else, and that's when it starts to get very dicey for us. Very dicey. That's why I say, you know, go to the Dharma Kings. I can't give you, you know, the kind of help they can give you. There's no way. Nobody should be counting on me to give them the highest kind of help or the amount of help they need. No way. That would be crazy. So go to the Dharma Kings and get their expert help. But I can give advice and turn you in the direction of the Dharma Kings so you don't fall into the clutches of those who may be out of continuity, if you're exploiting the situation, the desperation, to kind of try to stabilize themselves in doubt. Be the king and queen of doubt. Better look out for that. There's a lot of those types that come out of the woodwork, roaming about like dinosaurs, devouring devotees who are not grounded in the protection of the Dharma Kings. Yeah, I mean, they kind of chomp on you. Baba Sanva is there. He says, chomp on this, Barney. Barney the dinosaur. And he turns himself into a diamond, you know. A huge diamond. He says, chomp on this. His body turns into this perfectly hardened, pure diamond. And the dinosaur chomps on the diamond and whoops. Wow. That didn't taste good. Kind of might have hurt the chompers a little bit. They'll think twice about chomping on you again. Trying to chomp on Bhamasambhava. Yeah. They'll think, I better look out what I try to chomp on. I'm losing my confidence here, you know. That was what the dream I saw with all these dinosaurs, reptilians, marauding through the countryside. They were, I said, what are they doing? I think that was symbolizing these, they could be these exploiters of our desperation that come in and just get all these devotees, just grab a hold of so many and devour them, end up devouring them, spiritually devouring them. Yeah, I was really scared when I saw that dream. I said, oh my gosh, let's get out of here. This is really dangerous territory. They're rampaging throughout the land, these huge Tyrannosaurus Rex-like beings. Those may be, you know, fake gurus, fake teachers, exploiters of desperation, those eyes being shown. So call on the Dharma Kings and they'll protect you. They'll give you Vajra protection, diamond-like protection. Nobody's going to try and chomp on you. If they do it once, they'll realize they won't do it twice. They don't like the taste of diamonds. So we're desperate. Realize your desperation, and then you'll make wiser decisions. Yeah, would I said, okay, Papa Sava, all right, done deal. Took the Papa Sava pill, you know, have strong medicine. I guess the trepidation is like, oh my gosh, the dinosaurs aren't gonna like that. They're really gonna not like that at all. They're gonna get their chompers hurt, get their feelings hurt. Maybe they bite into Papa Sava. I said, oh, I thought you looked like a really nice spiritual delicacy to devour. Crunch! Oh, I got a toothache. Holy cow! You know, they're gonna go kind of moaning away. Be really angry with me, very cross. I said, well, you know, you shouldn't have been trying to chomp me. But that's what we do. Well, maybe you better change what your habits then. Turn to the Dharma and start evaporating your continuity fear, and everything, your habits will change. You'll lose interest in them. Ah, but I can't do that. I say, well, you got no choice. You have to do it. Everybody has to do it. It's just realize it's continuity fear, it's familiarity is your only problem there is, and then you'll say, oh, I could do that. So don't buy into these dinosaurs where they tell you they can't change. Of course they can. They're just, in their arrogance, refusing to recognize they have a familiarity problem. So just remind them, hey, all you have is a familiarity problem. You can do it. Everybody can do it. They will. As soon as you see that, you'll say, oh, I can do this. So just remind everyone of that, and don't buy another guilt trip. Oh, I can't do this. I can't change. I gotta devour you. I'm a devouring beast. No, you're not. Nobody is. No one is. That's just all continuity fear causing you to dance like a fool. Yeah, you're kind of afraid. We get protection. You know, the dinosaur's looking at you and says, "Just w I'm just waiting until you don't have any protection anymore, and then I'm really gonna crunch you." You know, so you get kind of w scared about that. I say, well, you know, you might have to wait a bit then. Wait, you got to wait a little longer. Wait a little longer, please, dinosaur. Well, you got no choice. You know, they're looking at you and say, "Ah, still got the protection, huh?" I have to wait a little longer. I'm getting hungry. He says, well, you know, hungry belly might motivate you to change your habits. Probably good for you. Use it as motivation. Use your frustration as motivation to repent. Well, they'll say, well, I don't like your attitude. I say, well, guess what? You get to not like it for a little while longer. Maybe it'll help you. Frustration is a very good motivator. Indeed, it is, right? It's great. You're frustrated. Come on. Then repent. Repent, repent, repent. Realize it's only continuity fear. Have compassion. Start having compassion on yourself, and you'll lose your appetite to chomp me up, huh? You won't be interested anymore. You'll forget all about it. Ah, it's getting late here. I'm expecting the rain to come in. Hasn't, but oh, I don't know how strong it'll be. But it's a really wet pattern we have now, so I wouldn't be surprised if we don't get some. It's actually supposed to start tomorrow midday or something. So I think it's a little early for it right now. Then it's supposed to go all day, and into the night through some of the night, and be a good soaking. We'll dry out eventually here, but we're in no hurry to dry out right now. You know, I love the clouds today. I just said, oh, it looks so nice, so dark and cloudy. That's a beautiful thing here. We haven't seen that in so long. It just, everything just feels like so much humidity, moisture in the air, and clouds, dark clouds. It feels like it's going to rain. It just, like it's just something that's set in. Is a beautiful feeling. We haven't felt that in so long. If you're in a real rainy place, it rains all the time. You get that feeling like, you know, it's going to rain. Just look and say, well, you know, cloud heavy clouds are always moving through. It's going to rain for sure. So we love to see that. Oh man. No doubt about it, rain luck is great because in the drought, it always threatened to rain and never rained. And we're going crazy. It's like, here comes another storm. They say, oh yeah, this one's going to be it. And it would come through and it looked like maybe it's going to rain and nothing, nothing, nothing. That extremely frustrating. We really got so agitated about that. So we love it when the clouds show up and they actually rain. And that's the mood of the feel of California right now. We got this feeling. It just feels like rain here now. It just feels that way, which is great. So, Imajo. Yeah. How marvelous. Wow. Wow. So, it's a marvelous time I've had to giving this little. Having this little visit with everyone. As usual, I don't really remember what I said, but it's here on tape. And I shouldn't have to remember what I said. I didn't want to think about it because I feel bad when I start thinking that way because it takes me out of the wow. It's just wow. What did I say? I said wow, didn't I? That's it. Imajo is what I said. Wow. We were in the flow of wow. We were really in the flow of wow. And that's what it's really about. The more we do that, the better it gets, isn't it? I find that the tapings get better and better and better because I've been doing it for so long. It's just comfort zone, you know, comfort. I can handle the wow. So I let it arise, let it happen. It's just okay. We can do this. I'm taking a break from my exercise today. I want to exercise, but I better not. It's possible to overdo it and start feeling real tired, but I feel okay. I feel okay, actually. Sore, that's for sure. Achy and sore, but overall, I'm not like worn out because I'm still eating. My weight's staying the same, so I'm not like I'm starving myself down to some even lower weight. And so I feel like I'm getting good nutrition. And yeah, I feel confident, pretty confident, feel pretty good. Imajo, wow. The knee still sore, but I don't notice so much during the day, not that painful. I don't notice that much. So I mean it's getting a little bit better, but it's still, you know, it's still an issue for sure. But I'm taking it easy on it. It's pretty easy on it and not doing anything stupid. It's not as strong as a healthy knee by any means. And we'll just be patient with it. Thank it. It must be saving me from taking action in the world, really, right? I was headed toward taking action, and this knee slowed me down. So it was just my continuity fear putting the brakes on me. So I thank the continuity fear for that, right? It's great service to block me from getting too fired up about I feel so wonderful, I feel so great, I can do something. You know, now I don't feel that way. I feel like laying low. So it really saved me. My bad knee saved me. It came out of nowhere. And I said, this is weird. It just blew up out of nowhere. And every time I try to get back into the flow of action, it flares up on me. So but when I'm laying low like this, it tends to get better. So I know it's some sort of braking mechanism. It's so dangerous, this world. We're so programmed to take action and be the hero and push through someone's agenda, and we get all the, you know, the flowers and the plaudits and the hero. Oh, what a, you know, you took such great action on our part. Isn't that wonderful? You're such a hero. It's so treacherous. The waters are so treacherous. You don't even want to go in those waters, because when people are desperate, they're looking for heroes to take action, to push their agenda through. You know. They feel the world's coming to an end. They're looking for those to stop that from happening. And if you're geared for action, which I am, then you're in big trouble because they're looking for you. There's some that are just, you know, geared like warriors or general types. I'm like a general type, you know, geared for action in terms of can just take on this persona of certainty. They're real strong certainty, confidence. They're looking for those are real confident and certainty to play the general role and fire the troops up and say, we are going to do this and we can't lose. And they're looking for that. Those who have these very strong agendas, very strong fears. The world's coming to an end. I'm not going to get what I want, what I need, what I, desire. I want my life, I feel like I should be empowered more. So then they look for those who will play the general and take the action, the warrior class, for example. And there are those, history. There's a warrior class and then the generals, and they then fight the wars for those who pull their strings and say, look, you'll be heroes of history. We'll throw great parades in your honor. You'll have the finest mansions and servants, and people will honor you, and we'll make busts of you, and you'll be in museums, and we'll write about you, and all this kind of stuff. There's a whole class of people that the ruling class and those who are associated in various ways of getting their way. They have a way of getting their way and getting others to do the fighting for them. And so there's that class of people like that in the world. There really is. There really is. And they're a very dangerous class of people because they get their way. They're very skilled at getting their way. And they start wars and start all conflicts and social movements, everything. Oh, the man I met today was telling me something. It's amazing. He said there used to be a convent here, and they're full of young women nuns back in the early 60s. And then John F. Kennedy started the Peace Corps, or was it Bobby Kennedy maybe started the Peace Corps? Yeah, I think it was Bobby. And one day Bobby Kennedy said, guess what, nuns? You're all joining the Peace Corps. I don't know what it was. Every single one of them joined the Peace Corps. They're all gone. The nunnery was abandoned. And they all went spread out all over the world. And it's funny because these nuns were young women, and their parents actively encouraged them to become nuns. They're extremely naive, very, very pure, naive young women that felt consecrated, that their parents said, this is good for you. And they followed their parents' advice and they became nuns. But then when Bobby Kennedy came along and said, hey, guess what, young ladies, you're now part of the Peace Corps, and you're going to do more good for the world as part of the Peace Corps rather than nuns. They all deserted their vocation, all left. Amazing, amazing, huh? Wow. Would have been better for them if they stayed nuns, to tell you the truth. Yeah, who knows? They may be part of the ruling class now who are getting everyone to fight their battles that they want to win, to try and consecrate their lives. People are trying to consecrate their lives by winning battles, whether it's over, the environment, whether it's over politics, whether it's over civil rights, whether it's over economics, global policy, whatever, it's over. There's a lot of battles that are being fought right now, in just every which way, rights of gender rights, this right, that right, and they're trying to consecrate their lives by winning these battles, but they're looking for the generals to rally the troops for them. This is a super dangerous time for generals. I'm definitely a general type, and so I realize I'm in really dangerous situation, to say the least, because it's hard for a general not to be a general. It's really difficult. I was a big shot in Europe in my previous life. I mean, I rallied all of Europe. I really did. People looked to me to rally the whole entire culture, save it from modernism, actually. So, I mean, I have a lot of experience of being a, big shot general type in history. And so I know that I easily can do that. I get fired up. I can be very fiery and adamant, and so it's hard for me to lay low. So this very dangerous situation for me. That's why I called in Padmasambhava. I had to call him in. I said, time to pull out all the stops, actually. Time to pull out all the stops. I'm in a big, very dangerous situation. Most people don't understand it because they're not generals. They can't do it, you know. The temptation doesn't exist for them because they never crossed their mind. But I could certainly be tempted into it, you know, seduced into it in all sorts of ways, very clever ways. So I have to, you know, absolutely, I'm doing a Padmasambhava Longchenpa, Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodro, 1 year, no action, silent action, silent intensive, no action, no action. No action. General Longchenpa has decommissioned me for the year. Says you are not to take active duty for this year. He's, you know, General Longchenpa is calling the shots directly. You know, he so, and then Padmasambhava is, you might say, he's the top commander in chief, Longchenpa will be like the top general, like General MacArthur, for instance, World War II. But the president, Padmasambhava, like Truman or something, or not, is that Truman? Yeah, the president, the commander in chief that can, you know, is even higher up, you might say, something like that. But they work beautifully, perfectly together. So Longchenpa is like, says you're not to take, you know, any active duty action at all for this year. You're just going to skip 217. No action, as if it doesn't exist. So I say, yes, sir. You know, that's a direct order. It's a direct Dharma order. Of course, those who would try to get you to take action completely disregard that. It doesn't mean anything. They don't care. They could care less. They could absolutely care less. They're very dangerous. You're just a means to their end. That's all they see. It doesn't matter what you say. They just don't even hear it. They don't even hear it. Very dangerous. You know, no doesn't exist in their vocabulary. You say no, and they're oblivious to it. You don't say no to them. You only say yes. So when you say no, they say, well, you're crazy. You know, you don't understand what I'm telling. You don't understand what I'm telling you. It's like the mafia. They give you orders and they say, you know, you say no, and they say, I don't think you understand what I'm telling you. You have to do what I'm telling you. I'm not giving you the option of not doing it. And I say, well, you know, take that up with Padmasambhava. You'll have to take that up with Padmasambhava. That's what I'm telling you. And I don't think you understand what I'm telling you. You know, to flip the script on them. The social mafia, the activist mafia in the world. And say to them, look, I don't think you understand what I'm telling you. You're going to have to chomp on Padmasambhava before you chomp on me. So, good luck with that. It's like eating diamonds. First you have to crunch up the diamond, though, and, you know, I don't think your teeth is going to like that too much. And they'll say, well, you're crazy. And I say, well, no, I don't think you understand what I'm telling you. Before you take any action believing that I'm crazy, you're going to have to take it up with Padmasambhava. And they keep saying you're crazy. Well, we'll see what kind of tune you sing later on down the road. I'm taking orders from Padmasambhava and Longchenpa, so you're calling them crazy. So take if you call me crazy, you're calling them crazy because I'm following their orders. So you take it to them and call them crazy. Don't bother me with that. So we need this kind of push. Okay, we need to push it like this. Hey, things are going to get really crazy here, for sure. If they say, well, Papa Stama, that doesn't exist, I'd say, well, then you don't exist either. So what doesn't exist can't possibly be telling me what to do. So if you say they don't exist to tell me what to do, neither do you then, because they're every bit as real as you are. So if you say you're not real, then you say they're not real, then you're saying you're not real either. So you couldn't possibly be telling me what to do. And then they'll say, well, I don't like you. Well, I'm following Papa Sama's orders. Somebody tell me you don't like his orders. Don't stop bothering me. I'm reminded of a cat I used to have, and this dog loved to chase cats, and this dog was a big intimidator, big woof woof, you know, huge bellows, charging. It's a very intimidating dog. So this dog roared into our yard and saw the cat, said, oh, there's a cat to chase. I'm going to scare the heck out of this cat and get a big ha 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 out of it, you know. Fun, so much fun. Dog loved to chase cats, so much fun. And afterwards, the dog would prance around like, ah, that was fun. You know, I'd love to set him to chase. And so he came roaring after my cat, but he didn't realize my cat was like a guru. And the cat didn't move a muscle. In fact, the cat turned around and says, oh, here comes a dog. This should be fun. And so the cat started charging at the dog. And the dog, you know, did a double take and said, what the heck? It jammed on the brakes, dug his front paws in, stopped, and his back paws like slammed into his front paws and went in front of me. He almost fell over backwards, which just was hilarious. And the dog was just like, he like backed off, like scared the heck out of us. I said, what in the heck is this? You know, and then afterwards, the dog's like kind of looking around, moping and slinking around. And after that, that cat intimidated the dog so bad, every time the dog came in the yard, the dog would like be looking, where's that cat? I don't want to see that cat. And then the dog would like kind of slink around the edge of the yard, like trying to carefully tiptoeing around. Ah, where's the cat? You know, it was hilarious. That big old bully dog was now terrified of the cat because he expected that cat to run. And this cat just ran straight at his face. Says, you want some of this? Oh, here comes. Oh, you want some of my claws, huh? Oh, I guess so. You're charging at me. You must be so eager to have my claws in your nose. And the dog, and you know, the dog says, maybe tomorrow, not today. And so that was it, man. That cat knew how to handle dogs. So it's like that. These those who come charging and say, hey, you got to do what I tell you to do. That's your role. Know your role. I said, well, I'm under orders from Papa Saba and Longchenpa. So know your role in that regard. Your role is to leave me alone. That's your role. And you don't like it, go talk to them. So they go, if they try to go charging after Papa Saba, they're going to get the news, you know? And they might not bother me anymore. It's quite possible. I say, what the heck? I thought I could intimidate. I thought I was the ultimate intimidator. The uber intimidator, you know. Huh. I can't quite understand this. What happened? Something ain't right. Something ain't right with my universe. No, everything's right. The universe, you know, those believe, the dinosaurs believe, is doubt. It's like, any moment now, doubt's going to show up. Any moment, this moment's not going to be this moment. And it hasn't happened yet, but we're thinking it's going to happen now. And no, doesn't happen. It's never going to happen. That's the Vajra heart. Vajrasattva. That's Vajrasattva. Bidance in Vajrasattva. Diamond mine. Seamless diamond mine. Dinosaurs don't like biting into that. They kind of slink away from it, like, stay away from me. We don't like you. Boo hoo. All right. So that's enough. Enough's enough, right? I could just go on riffing. It's like a jam session. You get some idea of how I used to be a musician, jam sessions when I was a musician. You get an idea. It might have been kind of fun. Because we jam for, man, long time, 4 or 6 hours. Made the Grateful Dead look like wimps. I mean, we would really just go on and on. I could just jam for so long, and we just new ideas were popping up all the time. Let's do this. Let's do this. Oh, this sounds great. I like this. I mean, it sounded great to us, but maybe other people say, well, I want to hear some song. We can't want to dance to this, and that's kind of danceable. But then you'd say they do something else, and I'm not sure what is this, the cha-cha, the rumba, the two-step, foxtrot, or I don't know. It doesn't, I don't know if I can dance to this. It's the boogie. It's the watusi. It's the whatever, locomotion. We kept shifting and changing and doing different stuff, and so people kind of said, it's not really party. We're not really a, it's not a party band. We were not a party band. We were jammers. That was the spirit of the time. The Grateful Dead, were doing that. We were doing that. If you get a song, you might go for half an hour, an hour on the song. And you just get the basic riff and stuff, and you just see what would come up, see what we can do, see where the creativity leads us. We don't have any set expectations. I understand, that whole scene, the jamming scene, yeah. It's great. So we're kind of spiritually jamming here. It's a spiritual jam session. As I say, I'm a spiritual musician now, and I do spiritual jam sessions. But it's not everyone's cup of tea. And we had people would listen to us. There are some that really liked it, but the social set really didn't like it. They were there to look good dancing. They wanted to catch people's eyes, by how they looked. And it was about them and dancing, and the music was a backdrop to make them look good. But for us, it was all about the music and the jamming and the ideas and the creativity and the wow that came up. And we had a blast. I had a blast. I mean, just I could do so many sound effects on amplifiers, like Hendrix, or just all sorts of different stuff. It was just whatever we could find, whatever sounds we could come up with. We were just experimenting, experimenting, experimenting of what can we get out of these instruments and amplifiers and all this stuff, What can we do? And let's just, no rules, let's just hit the road, road trip, see what we come across. We're very adventurous that way. It's pretty amazing. Pretty amazing, man. That was, you look back on that. Wow. Miss it. Miss it. It's to be young again and in that mood, except this time, with different circumstances, we could make it better. But, it was what it was. And thank God I didn't get too good at it, or I would have ended up like the Grateful Dead, in the party rave scene back then. Kind of really, I was that good, but I didn't have the charisma to do it. It was there wasn't as a commitment, professional commitment to it, like the Grateful Dead had. But musically, I could have done it, no question about it. But my heart wasn't totally into it. It was into the Dharma more than it was into the music. So Dharma first, music second. And I didn't. I was more serious. I didn't really want to spend my life that way, but I could have. Could have done that for sure. When it came to jamming, I was really good at it. I wasn't so good at playing set music at all. I didn't want to. I didn't learn set songs. For me, it was about pow, wow. It was about wow. Let's find the wow in music. Let's see if we can discover a whole bunch more wow in music. And so let's go for it. Crank the amps up to 12, and let's see what we can come up with. Yeah, that was really very intense stuff and amazing times. Because it was uncharted territory, very uncharted territory we were in at that time. And we'd listen to these great, like Hendrix and Clapton and these great musicians, and we'd get all these ideas from them, and they'd say, hey, let's also push it and let's see what we can do. See what we can do as GarageBand, let's let it rip here. People would come and listen, absolutely. But we didn't pay much attention to the audience at all, actually. We were just into the music. People would come and go like that. And it was like, wow, fun, kind of. But we weren't really into it for the fun. We were actually really trying to see, can we find some really wowish music? Can we find some sublime music? Well, that's what we were really searching. We were searching for certainty in music, some sort of rootlessness in music. That, this is just floating here. It's just so beautiful, and it's just as it is right now. And just stay in the vibe. In music, you call it the groove. You get in the groove. And just everything, when you're in the groove, everything sounds great. And that's what you're looking for. You go into the right mindedness so strongly that you can't miss. You're just in the groove. And then people feel that, and then they say, wow, he's in the groove, or they're in the groove right now. And this, yeah. You can feel it. So, and then you'd search for new grooves that are even better. And that gets ragged. As you're searching for a groove, it sounds disjointed. But then when you start to find the groove and stuff fits together, all fits together, then suddenly you've got new music. Something that you hadn't heard before. A new groove. And so we were always finding new grooves. But it's ragged. It's stressful and it's ragged. And some people want to find familiar grooves. Hey, I want to have a groove that I'm familiar with. I want to dance to it. I want to feel the groove. Some song that's popular or something. But we were looking for new grooves. So, yeah. Same spiritually. I was looking for new grooves. I was looking for a new groove, and finally I found it here. Full stop. And wow, is the new groove that for me, I feel I'm in the groove of it, and it's my thing. It's my style. So musically, if you find your groove, then you found a style that's just really. It's a really strong groove, and everything you do just really flows beautifully. But it becomes your style. Like for instance, like the Bee Gees. The Bee Gees had a style. Okay, and they were just, they were fabulous at it, really. And it just all sounded good. Whatever they did just was great. But it was their sound, It was their sound, their groove. They found it. They developed it. And nobody did it better. And so when you find your groove, then that's your groove. That's your style. So this is what I do. I found my groove. So now it's smoother. It's a lot. I'm not too raggedy. It's flowing. It's smooth. Full stop in the wow. Dharma Kings. One insight settles it all. There's never been any doubt. Everything is completely rootless, just floating in rootless, pure spaciousness, pure awareness. Wow. Okay. That's the groove. That's the groove. So, when you find your groove and it's a strong groove, then you're a professional. So that'd be like the Grateful Dead. They had a groove. They found their groove, and so they were very professional at it. and they gave a lot of concerts, and a lot of people started coming and hearing because they knew what their groove was. They knew what their thing was. They knew what their thing was. Even though it was being creative there, there was still some structure that they understood, you know, this is how we groove here. So you'd say they're professional. So when you find your groove, then you're a professional. So that's why Longchampa calls me a Dharma prince. I mean, I'm a professional now, and I found my groove. So the talks just are easy. They just flow. Spontaneously just flow. Like I'm just jamming, but it's good jamming. Like Jerry Garcia, you know, he jammed really, really great. I'm not a deadhead, but I've heard him play. I mean, you know, he's good. You know, they put out really soulful, you know, cool music. I haven't heard a lot of it. I mean, there's so much of it. Some people have heard so much of it, but what I've heard is just, yeah, I understand that he was really talented, really good, got a really good sound from his guitar. He had his thing. He had his groove, and he knew his groove, and he did it well. And it flowed. He was able to flow. It all kept flowing. It kept flowing. It kept flowing. So it's like that. When you get able to flow, it just spontaneously flow. You found your groove like that. That means, wow, hit me hard. This wow is very powerful. I don't know if I'll be able to sleep tonight. Yes. At least I don't have to take action. It's getting late now. It's like 12, 11:40, and so I'll go to bed, and I don't know if I'll be able to sleep. This is very powerful. I cook up large amounts of carrots, broccoli, cauliflower, and so I'm snacking. Like at dinner, I'm making dinner for others. I'm just like snacking on these, vegetables. That's pretty healthy, huh? So I eat a lot of those veggies plus kale for in my smoothie in the morning. So I'm getting a lot of really the best vegetables, actually. Just because I cook up a big batch, so there's lots of leftovers. I mean, cook up an entire cauliflower at once, That's a lot. Cauliflower is a lot there. So, yeah, this, wow. I don't feel like taking any action at all, really. I just feel in this very profound state. But it's just a feeling, a wow feeling. There's no labels that I can attach to it really. It's very intense. Like that wind, it's like a storm is coming or something powerful is coming. Rain is coming. You can hear the wind howling. It's pushing. Well, the wow means there's a big breakthrough on its way. Big breakthrough on its way when you feel wow like this. It means we've gone into some really great territory here. Is this, the overall momentum has increased to a tremendous extent. This is where the wow kicks in. Very great. Let's see if I can move a little bit here, but it's subsiding a little bit. But I could stay here for some more, but yeah, a little subsiding just enough so I can wrap things up here. Wow. Amazing. Tremendous, tremendous, tremendous. Okay. Very great. That's it for this spiritual jam session. Wow. Imaho.